And also the bursar, or anybody who hasn't already come up with their tuition should see the bursar. Well, our speaker tonight is Nancy Hill. And she is the lovely lady sitting over here on my right and your left. She has a couple of books to introduce you to. She's a birder. That means she watches our avian friends.
Can't remember.
She notices what's going on in the sky, mostly during the day. That has made her very cognizant of problems of viewing the sun. And so she will tell us all about that. Sun halos and...
Let's welcome our speaker. You too, Bob.
Well, good evening, everyone. And first of all, I want to thank you for having me here tonight. My name is Nancy Hill. And my main objective tonight is to draw your attention and your powers of observation to what is going on in our sky. Hopefully you'll come to the same conclusion that I have and millions of other people across the globe have, and that is that planes are spraying something deliberately in our skies. That the contrails we're seeing are not contrails, but in fact they're chemtrails. Now let me see if I...
Doesn't it work? There you go.
Okay. Just a little bit about myself first, so you know who I am. I was born and raised in Chicago. I'm married. I have three daughters, a granddaughter. I live up in Gurnee. My corporate experience was about 25-30 years, mainly in the commercial insurance industry in a niche marketplace where we provided services. I've now been working for a family business for about 7 years and took up as hobbies that I'm very passionate about, which is birding and photography, which brought me to get involved with environmental issues. First one I got involved with was mountaintop removal. Was absolutely flabbergasted that they are blowing up the Appalachian Mountains. And I spent some time working on that and providing pictures when I could for publications and such. And then I did get involved as well with the coal issue, especially down in southern Illinois, and what that's doing to our state. But one day, I was sitting editing pictures in my home office, and I looked out my window and I saw this grid pattern. And now I've lived mostly in the Chicago area, and I know all about O'Hare, and I know all about air traffic, but when I saw this, I thought, what is this? This is not normal. And quite frankly, it scared me. So I started doing all sorts of research.
Just let me know. What did you want?
Hold on one second.
Okay.
And it was not the first time that I've ever noticed a trail in the sky, but it was the first time this had happened outside of my home. This was in March of 2014. Also earlier in that month, we were driving back from Florida. We were down visiting my mother, and we saw all these trails in the sky coming back from Kentucky. And we thought, that's not right. That's very strange. And I took pictures of those, but I didn't save them until this happened. This is an example of what I saw early on. And in this picture
here,
that started out as a small little trail. And in probably 10 minutes time, it went, now this is in the back of my
yard,
it went from a very small little trail in the horizon and literally shot across the sky and down over my house. It was like something out of a science fiction movie. It was like the fickle finger of death flying up. I mean, I was literally under a tree there in the last picture because it frightened me. So I started doing research.
Thank you.
I started logging every day what I saw, had to figure out what is a condensation trail, what is a contrail, when can they form, what kind of atmospheric conditions need to prevail for these to be even exist. I started photographing every day. I think I must have well over 3,500 pictures at this point. And this is a first, you know, I used to like to take pictures of birds. That was my joy. I mean, there was no more joy that I ever had previously other than being out in the field and being out in the woods and photographing birds. And now I'm photographing airplanes because I'm looking up and this is what I see. I started doing research on the internet, and if you put in the term chemtrail, it will come up, and almost every site is debunking that term. So you read all sorts of things about, you know, they wear tinfoil hats and they're conspiracy theorists, and there's a lot of information out there telling you why a chemtrail is not a chemtrail. As a matter of fact, the wiki page continues to change. So now I want to show you some of the pictures. So most of these pictures were taken right around my home, but this is often what you'll see at dusk or sunset, and that is the spray at sunset. So all those lines that you see radiating up, those were all from planes. And I watched the planes spray those lines, and I watched the lines expand. This is right over my house. Now, we've lived there just for 5 years, but I can tell you that not in the previous 4 have I ever seen something like this right over at my house. It was one after another. These are all trails that expanded. They last for hours. Here's another one of the western sky. These are all trails. I call them trails, not chemtrails. I'm trying to not use chemtrails because it's a lot of people that are involved with this movement are trying to tell us to get away from using that term, because if you do Google it, it will come up and be nothing but disinformation. But this was actually an almond marsh, where I usually go birding, and the beginning of that day was sunny. Now it's about 4 o'clock, and every single line you see in that sky was from a plane. I lost count. And what was interesting that day is I saw a gentleman came in, and I've got a big lens, and he said, "What bird do you have?" And I said, "I don't have a bird. I'm taking pictures of that." And he said, "What?" I said, "What the planes are doing." And he looked. I said, "Look at the sky." And then he was, "Oh, I see." So it's interesting to see that. I think this has been going on so long that people have kind of not even noticed it. They don't notice it. You actually have to say, this is what it is. And quite frankly, when I first started realizing this had been going on for a while, I was shocked at myself that I hadn't noticed these earlier. And now when I go back and I look at my own old photographs, I can see evidence of this, that this was going on at least 10 years ago in my photographs. This is up at Zion, another sunny day that the planes came from the east in the morning, and this is the havoc they wreaked in the sky. Sun dogs. You know, I call them cottage cheese clouds. It's just, there's nothing normal about this in the backyard. So contrails. Contrails very rarely are beneath 30,000 feet. They're typically 30,000 feet and up. The sky, it has to be -40 at least for contrail to form, And key is the relative humidity has to be 60 to 70%. Now, I am not a weatherman, I am not a scientist, but what I do understand is the higher you get, the thinner the air is, the colder it is, and the situation where you're going to have negative 40 and relative humidity of 70% is extremely rare. And if you think back to when we were all younger, you didn't see chemtrails. They were rare. You'd go in and ask, you'd point it out to somebody. Look at that. What is that? Oh, that's a plane. Now they're every day. Every day that you can see the sky, you will see chemtrails. But not on every plane. I mean chemtrails, but not on every plane. Many people will say, well, it's increased air traffic. And they come up with all these reasons that these are actually chemtrails. What I'm going to show you now is a number of flight patterns that are not normal anywhere that I've ever seen. Oh, what if we got out of line, out of order here a little bit, but why I'm posting this is we have a group on, there's hundreds of group on Facebook. There are thousands of groups, people all over the world that network and talk about the chemtrails. And we actually have a map that we post on a daily basis, and we put a mark. We've got one person, an administrator of it, but we'll put a mark every day on the cities and states where people have seen planes spraying. And we also have people in Canada and Mexico as well.
Nancy, why were some states not colored?
Well, they're not. We do have people in every state. It's either that nobody saw them, it was cloudy. You know, it's not every day that every state is. And they're doing this. They have kept these for probably, I think they have 5 years worth of maps. So they're just keeping it as evidence, kind of like I'm doing with my pictures. So, okay, so this was the 4th of July last year. Now, what kind of planes fly like this right next to each other? They were coming straight out of the west, and they came up and over, and, you know, this is not a normal flight pattern, at least that I've heard. Oh, okay, flight radar. One of the things that I did when I first saw these is I found out there's flight radar available to the public. You can go, and any plane that is transponding over you, you should be able to see real time its altitude, where it left, what its destination is. It's got all sorts of statistics on it. You can also go back in time. So if I can't get to my computer quick enough and I want to check on a certain particular airplane, I can go back in time and check to see if it was on flight radar. So I spent weeks and weeks and weeks doing nothing but taking pictures, going back, checking relative humidity, and checking to see if the plane was on flight radar. 99% of the time, they weren't on flight radar. So who are these planes? Now the FAA has to know who these planes are, where they're taking off, and where they're landing. But it's not on the publicly administered flight radar. X's, this is right in my backyard. They make X's and all sorts of designs. It's another one. You'll see, you start watching now, hopefully you'll see them. Patterns, time of day. Again, this is in the west. They're in the west, blocking the western sun, the setting sun. In the morning, start looking in the morning and you'll see haze most of the time over the sun rising. There are also very high flying jets. My guess is military. They're higher than the other ones, maybe at 40,000. I'm just guessing. Way high. You can't hear them. That also are spraying. They seem to turn their engines on and off. Now, how does a plane do that? We've seen flights do this right next to each other. Does that look like ice crystals to you? They drip. Sometimes they excite and they go upwards. They move out sideways. They move lengthwise. They're not acting like ice crystals. This is just a, that's part of a day, the one with the two flights. It was a Sunday, I'll never forget, I went out and there were literally five planes coming directly from the east, going over our house, like all in a row, this close, five of them. It was 9 o'clock on a Sunday morning. It's not a normal traffic pattern, flight pattern. And of course, none of them were on flight radar, and the relative humidity was probably around 20%, which is it usually is.
Bring you all your
church. I should have been church. So, people talk about the fact that, well, there's increased air traffic. We spend a lot of time in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. They have more planes than they used to. When we were kids and there was a plane, everybody ran out of the house and said, look, look, there's a plane, because they never had them. Now, they're getting the tandem flights. They're getting flights on radar. The skies that were used to be blue are now, you know, they're trail after trail, and they spread out and they block the sun. This is also in the UP. This picture and this one I add in here because some people will say, well, there's just more air pollution. Well, there is no manufacturing anywhere near this, the part of the UP that we go to, nowhere close. And those clouds don't look clean. They're reflecting some kind of chemical, I think. So when it comes to clouds are another thing that do not look like they did when we were kids. As a matter of fact, you don't see this kind of sky often at all anymore. It's typically hazy. Let me know. But what we do see a lot of are sun halos, which you see here. That's the haze that we get on a daily basis if it's sunny. And oh, by the way, they call this sunny on the Weather Channel. This is a progression of about 3 hours time, beginning of the day, and as they lay trail after trail and they spread out, you have the haze that you see at the end there. And I'm sure you've all seen those translucent skies. It's like, what kind of clouds are those? It's a plasma. So another day, locally, I lost track of the number of planes. You've got the dripping trails in there and spreading, and this is the plasma that I'm talking about. And there are, by the way, and I will show some of the information, there are 150 different patents covering everything that we're talking about with geoengineering. And there is a patent regarding forming artificial plasma. And look at this. There are two parts to the weather manipulation. One is, or are the aerosol trails that are laid, the chemicals, whatever they're spraying. They say that it's aluminum, barium, strontium, lithium, there's a whole list, and these are listed in the patents. The other part of it is HAARP. And HAARP is, it's quite frankly, it's over my head as far as scientific, so I can only go so far in explaining it, but it has to do with electromagnetic frequencies. It was invented. Eastland used some of Tesla's work, but what they do is they shoot these electromagnetic waves into the chemicals, into the metal chemicals in the sky, and this is what you see. You can see the ripples. It allows them to manipulate where the particles are going and what kind of clouds are being created. Here's another example. And I see these frequently. But I made it black and white because it you can see more clearly what's going on there. I think up in Gurnee. In Gurnee. But I've seen this, you know, I've seen this all across the country. That's where most of the pictures are. Now this one I think I took driving. One of these days look at that. I ran around for the first 3 or 4 months saying, look at that. Every day that I see it, I feel like I'm seeing it for the first time because I still cannot believe it is happening. Here's another example of carpet work in the scalar waves. We have these melting clouds, we call them jellyfish. I mean, what kind of clouds? I don't know. The rare sun dog. I mean, these are rare, but during the summer, you will see them often. This is something I am just curious about, and I throw this out there.
Do you remember when the Aurora radar station was burned?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, I thought that was very odd, and I have a quote. During that period of time, I think it was down 13 days, for the first 10 days I saw not one chemtrail. I saw normal traffic, which was reduced, but I saw not one chemtrail. Doesn't mean they weren't doing it at night, but I thought that was an oddity. And he, in the last hurrah, wrote a piece on his Facebook page. And I wanted to read this to you. He said that this shouldn't take a toll, but who knows, due to government employees being in charge. Many of them live up to exactly how they are viewed by the public, lazy and useless. We say how they exist, but they don't care. I need to try. I want to make this difference. I have no faith. Not in humanity, anyway. You are all about death, as I was not too long ago. All I see, a government who would rather take care of itself and the money in the world, definitely not its people. Though since the people don't care, what could change? Wake up. Government, immoral, unethical acts. I took a hard look in the mirror. I have, and this is why I'm about to take out ZAU in my life. April Pop, love you guys, and I'm sorry. Feel like I give a shit for the first time in a long time, but not for long, ha. Huh? So, and one of the things that we need to go back to is I do have a clip of one of the first whistleblowers that I came across.
Okay, you want to play it now?
Sure, yeah.
Okay.
Her name is Kristen Megan, and she actually is here in Chicago. And when Tom asked me if I could find a speaker, I actually asked her, but she's right now laying low because she's filed for whistleblower status, because there is a list of whistleblowers and some have untimely ends and I don't know. Yeah.
Trying to get to it now. Okay. Now I'm trying to get to that. Okay. Sorry about that.
Oh, that's okay. I skipped right by it.
All right. Ready? Now,
right, this is Kristen.
Let me grab your mic.
I'm going to have to start it again.
You're not going to have a whole clip play in just about 7 minutes.
Yeah, I heard you.
So I enlisted in the U.S. Air Force. My job in the U.S. Air Force was working in bioenvironmental engineering. So what bioenvironmental engineering is in the Air Force is equivalent to that of the OSHA and the EPA, if you're familiar with that. So we were an embedded liaison to make sure that we were tracking all of the aspects and impacts of the military, meaning what is the military doing and how is it impacting the environment, because we were accountable for that. Being government, we did not get any special treatment. We just couldn't be fined being another federal agency. EPA can, but not OSHA. So from the health side, it was knowing what you do in the Air Force. What does your job entail that is hazardous to your health? And I'm going to give you an example. Let's say that you were an aircraft painter. You were a mechanic. My job would go out to make sure I knew everything that you did, what you were exposed to, and how to mitigate and engineer out those hazards. Because we needed to, one, it's your legal right to be working in a safe and healthful work environment. So throughout 9 years, I worked as an industrial hygienist and an environmental specialist. One of, actually, there's two bases I was at that are called air logistics centers. What does that mean? It's not like a fighter wing, you know, it's not really fun and amazing. What they did is they took aircraft that around every 10 to 15 years, they're required to be dismantled down to the last screw. So that meant every single industrial process you can think about, checking the metal integrity, making sure everything's good to go, or sometimes overhauling equipment. Part of my job in tracking the health hazards was to look at any time someone wanted to buy a chemical, any type of chemical. It was ordered through a system, and in that system, I had to go in there and say, you know, the country we're in, we're not allowed to use this. We need to substitute it out with something a little less hazardous, while also maintaining the integrity for a technical order, meaning for that process, it says you must use, you know, xylene or toluene to do this process. Well, I have to kind of fast forward. I want to say around 2006, I started kind of opening my eyes to how the military wasn't really what I thought it was. And people approached me knowing what I did for a living and said, have you ever heard of chemtrails? Well, I hadn't. And that sparked my interest. So I went online and I looked at chemtrails. I saw a lot of, you know, debunking, a lot of sites that were just kind of calling it a conspiracy theory. And I thought, well, geez, this is what I do for a living. Preventive health, making sure that people are not getting sick, especially in the workplace, and by things that we're doing that can affect, you know, human health and the environment. To summarize, in an attempt to debunk this conspiracy theory as I thought it was, I didn't debunk it. It literally changed my life. Like I said, this is hard for me because it's not easy standing here and telling my story. One day I was going through that computer system, which if you want to look it up, it's called an Air Force Form 3952. It is the approval of hazardous materials. I was finding tons and tons of large quantities of aluminum, barium, strontium in the forms of oxides and sulfates. And of course I knew that there's industrial processes you may not have heard of, but it's bead blasting, pneumatic sanding, shot peening. There is certain medias that's similar to that is used. However, I had already accounted for that. I would sit and look at this computer system and say, this shop wants to order this paint. I'm gonna tie it to a task. We had to know what was being used, why it was being used, tracking it cradle to grave on how we were gonna dispose of it to be compliant with OSHA and the EPA. One of the legal requirements in approving these is looking at what used to be called the material safety data sheet. On that sheet, it's going to list the manufacturer. It's going to list some maybe required personal protective equipment that needs to be used or some ways to mitigate the exposures. These electronic MSDSs did not have a manufacturer name. They were very vague. They almost looked to me like somebody had made it and scanned it into the system. So I asked the question. What is this being used for? I never got an answer, so I didn't approve it. And it sat there. And then the heat came down. Why aren't you, are you behind on your 3952s? Only a select few of us did that. So I started asking questions. And at that point, my demonization began. You know, I made my rank. I was decorated. I was a non-commissioned officer of a quarter. I won lots of awards. I had no reason for anyone to attempt to demonize me. So then I get moved over to the other Air Logistics Center. There's only two in the Air Force, which is in Warner Robins, Georgia. This kind of carried with me. And I thought, you know what? Should I revisit this? Is it worth it? Did I hit something? Maybe it's need to know. I started finding the same things at Robins Air Force Base. I was now doing some more investigation work. Part of what I did was to use a high volume air sampler to air sample up to, I'd say, a football field in about 10 minutes. I also conducted soil sampling because I thought, you know, if this is real, if they are spraying this, it's gonna get to the ground. So I conducted air sampling, I conducted soil sampling, and I was getting high levels of these contaminants. When I started asking the question again under a new commander, I never in my life thought I would have somebody look me in the face and tell me, I am questioning you. Is there something wrong with you? You've been looking really depressed lately.
You know I can put you on our mental evaluation for up to 120 days. Who would take care of your daughter? Because I was divorced at the time. As soon as I heard that, I knew. It validated everything I ever thought. And I thought, I've spent 9 years of my life trying to protect human health, and here we are, violating law after law after law. Just sitting here, instead of protecting the people, we are poisoning the people. And I've never got up so much courage from that fear of being thrown in a cage, because when you're in the military, folks, you're a number. You are a number, and every aspect of your life is controlled. I was so lucky that my enlistment was coming up and I was supposed to re-enlist. I ran and did not look back. And I have been blowing the whistle and shouting ever since. And I left October 27, 2010.
How much?
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Back to the slideshow now.
Back to the slideshow.
Okay. Let's go back. Okay, there we are. Aurora. All right, how much further you got to go?
Next one.
So, what?
Oh.
Sorry about that. Now, where do we go from here now?
Right there.
Right there?
GeoEngineering. Next one.
All right.
That's okay. I'll go right.
Okay.
Okay, so GeoEngineering, what is it? Geoengineering encompasses strategies to combat and reduce the effects of global warming and climate change. It's the deliberate and large-scale intervention in the Earth's climatic systems. Some of the components. Thank you. Some of the components of geoengineering: solar radiation management, carbon dioxide removal, which you've probably heard of, stratospheric aerosol geoengineering, albedo management, and climate engineering. Now, these are all terms that, if you want to look up information on this process and what I'm talking about tonight, these are the terms to use, not the chemtrails. So patents, again, there are patents, 150 patents, and they cover every process having to do with how to change the weather, basically, and what kind of chemicals to use, and it's all very technical, and again, I'm not a technical person, but you can look these up. It's all available on the internet. One of the main patents that people talk about is the stratospheric Welsbach seeding. And basically what this talks about is how to change the climate in a particular area using aluminum sprayed as nanoparticulates or aerosols. HARP is the other piece of this. It's not just the sprays. HARP, NEXRAD, and other EMF transmission technologies can now manipulate the saturated atmosphere via electromagnetic frequencies for various weather/climate modification and military applications. Plasma is an ionized gas. This gas carries an electrical charge. Now, due to the aerosols being dispersed, the atmosphere is full of nanoparticulates. Aerosols are not the only sole requirement. Again, the high-energy ionospheric heaters, Tesla arrays, and other electromagnetic devices are required to interact with the chemical aerosols, direct and control them. The Navy is actually responsible for maintaining the HARP facility up in Alaska, but there are 4 to 5 other HARP arrays that cover the globe. And speaking of patents, Monsanto has a patent for aluminum resistant seed. How did they know that they would need an aluminum resistant seed? And why did they buy the Climate Corporation several years back? The Climate Corporation is one of the largest depositories of weather data in the world. They also, oh by the way, sell insurance, like crop insurance. Monsanto now owns them, as well as owning B-Logix, which is was the largest researcher that existed that was doing research on colony collapse. This just shows where some people, and there's not proof on the NEXRAD piece, but NEXRAD is like radar Doppler. Some people think that NEXRAD and their electromagnetic frequencies can also help to manipulate the weather. So who's involved with geoengineering? One of the top geoengineers, his name is David Keith. He's at Harvard now, and he's a Harvard scholar, and he also is involved with several different corporations, one of which is being financed by Bill Gates. He wants to do small-scale field testing. He said it is by no means clear what the right answer is or how much we should spray, if anything. How we should use it. But the balance of evidence from the climate models used to date suggests that doing a little bit would reduce climate change. I don't know what a little bit means. There's also part of this video, which was given recently in 2010 during a meeting in San Francisco. And someone asked him, well, have there been any studies on how these aluminum nanoparticulates are going to affect humans? And he said, no, there hasn't been. And by the way, it's not really a moral hazard, it's more like free riding on our grandkids. So some of the agencies that are involved are NASA. Now, the reason why I say that is because they're involved in, there are many, many conferences, climate conferences, geoengineering conferences. You can take classes on geoengineering at MIT and Harvard and many of the universities. The IPCC is involved. It's really talked about more outside of the United States. Some of the conferences that they have, their sponsors are companies like Chevron, Lockheed Martin, Swiss Re, Ball Aerospace and Tech, Boeing, Ecotech, FM Global, Geometric, GeoRes, John Hopkins Applied Sciences Physical Labs, Los Alamos National Lab, Marine Sciences, and Google. Oh, this is the Monsanto. They changed. Sorry, working off of two and I changed the sequence.
Don't worry. You're doing real good.
So, actually what I'd like to skip to is this. Back in 1996, the Air Force published a paper, which of course you have access to, and it's called Owning the Weather in 2025. And in this paper, and I will quote, we show that the appropriate application of weather modification can provide battle space dominance to a degree never before imagined. In the future, such operations will enhance air and space superiority and provide new options for battle space shaping and awareness. The technology is there, waiting for us to put it all together. And in 2025, we can own the weather.
Yes, sir.
Controlling the weather really is something that people have been wanting to do and have been talking about for a long time, and the technology is there. Okay, I have included a number of the different organizations and books and information available just to show to you this is no small topic. Like Andy said, in preparing for this, there's so much information out there. It's difficult to whittle it down. So what I really wanted to try to do is just show you what I've seen and then show you where you can do your research and that information is out there. I think I'm going to jump to, cost. People say, what is this going to cost? How could we possibly be paying for this? The cost of carbon removal has been shown to be more expensive. The British government did an analysis that concluded that even just cutting emissions by 25% by 2050 would cost about $1 trillion. Whereas the cost of spraying aerosols, particularly aluminum, is cheap, only a few billion yearly. Cost is not an issue, per Keith. What needs to be weighed is simply the cost of not doing it versus the cost of not doing it versus the risk of not doing it. He and others did a cost analysis and determined the technological capability to deliver material to the stratosphere at 1 million tons a year exists today, and a few million tons would be sufficient to alter the radiative forcing by an amount equal to the growth of greenhouse gases over the next 15 years for $8 billion annually. So who's paying for this? I found an article in Reuters that talked about how the Department of Defense has not accounted for $8.5 trillion in taxpayer money since 1996 when they were supposed to start accounting for it. Every month they have to balance the books with what the U.S. Treasury says they should be spending and how much money they should have. They have to plug the numbers. In 2012, for example, the Pentagon's budget was $565.8 billion, and that year they had a $9.22 billion plug. So I think that might cover the cost of the $8 billion for the aerosol. In other words, there's plenty of unaccounted for money in our government that could be paying for this. So the risks. Alan Robeck, who is a scientist at Rutgers, come out with this list of risks and benefits. The benefits are reducing the surface temperature. Another one that we already see is the beautiful red and yellow sunsets. You ever notice how all the sunsets, when there's a sunny day? I mean, they're spectacular, just spectacular. The risks, drought in Africa and Asia. Ozone depletion. I'm picking out some that I'm seeing already. Degrading passive solar heating. One of the people at the forefront of against geoengineering, his name is Dane Wigington. He's another person who's good to look up. He has a huge solar installation in California. And he got involved with geoengineering because he saw his numbers going down. He wasn't getting the sunlight and the output that he expected, and he started watching the sky, and he went on to test the soils, and he's done a lot of work in this. But when it comes to the drought in Africa, one of the things that, and in the book, This Changes Everything, they talk at length about how history will teach us what happens if there are aerosols in the atmosphere. And when Mount Pinatubo blew, one of the results was a change in the monsoons in India. The monsoon season didn't happen, and the temperatures went up. And they, of course, depend on most of their fresh water. They get most of it during the monsoon season. This year, and just recently, 2,500 people have died in India due to heat, and their monsoon season isn't happening. So some of the risks that they come out and state are already taking place. Now, some of these examples are more anecdotal, but this aluminum is raining down on all of us and everything, including birds, bees, the fish, the trees. There are groups that do nothing but study trees. There's been a huge tree decline. But we all have heard, I'm sure, over the past 3 years of these strange deaths of, 2,000 snow geese recently in Idaho just dropped dead all at once, dropped dead out of the sky. They said it was avian flu. They tested, avian flu wasn't, I looked the other day and they still have not come out and said what actually caused it. They have not found, they've not discovered what it was. They have no answers. And speaking of bees, recently, this came out just a couple days ago, there are some scientists in the UK that are actually studying bee pupa and determining that there's a high level of aluminum in bee pupa. So people are starting to study this. Human health issues. Now again, you can't prove this, like you can't prove that fracking is causing earthquakes, but there's something going on, okay? The greatest cause right now of children in the United States being admitted to hospitals is upper respiratory issues. Asthma, autism, Alzheimer's, the rates are skyrocketing and there is a connection with those issues and aluminum. Many, many people have done tests on rainwater, soil, blood and hair that have all shown elevated amounts of aluminum. This is a friend of mine that lives in Switzerland, and she was talking about how Switzerland used to have sunny days. They're in the Alps. They're in the Alps, and the Alps block the formation of clouds. And she said that they used to have. She said we used to have 300. Sunny blue skies a year. This was due to the fact that we're surrounded by the Alps, which create a natural block to the passage of clouds. Unfortunately, this is a thing of the past. We're lucky if we have 50 blue skies a year now. This is what it looks like now. You talk to people in California, Arizona, they'll all tell you the same thing. We used to have these sparkling blue skies, we don't see them. Conditioning and subliminal messaging. This has also taken place over a number of years with disinformation campaigns against chemtrail believers as tinfoil hat wearing crazy people. In one of the academic reports that I read, there was actually a note in the middle of one of the beginning pages that said, beware of conspiracy theorists who say chemtrails exist and are being used already. They basically go on to say that's totally unfounded. Now, this isn't a scientific document. There are paid trolls on the internet that cause arguments, dissent, division. They discredit you. They try to get people to argue. Oh, by the way, chemtrails were not that term was actually dubbed by the government. It wasn't people just saying, oh, let's just, hyphenate that. There was a Space Preservation Act, and H.R. 2799 and 20001, sponsored by Kucinich. It did not pass, but in it says, chemtrails would have been banned for use is they would have been classified as an exotic weapon through the use of land-based, sea-based, space-based systems, etc. You cannot using radiation, electromagnetic, psychotropic, sonic, laser, or other energies directed at individual people or targeted populations. One of the exotic weapons that would be excluded were chemtrails. So I just added some pictures in here that you will see. You see it on a daily basis. Center for Disease Control, look at their logo and the picture.
Yeah.
You see this on the local news, on your phone apps. We went to Utah in Bryce Canyon, this was last year, and this was their ad. And this is what happened when we got there. My daughter and I started at the, well, one is of the slots, but the next picture, that's my daughter on a horse, clear blue sky. We were on those horses for 2.5 hours down the canyon, and I saw planes flying from one edge to the next, back and forth the whole time. And if you go around it this way, that last picture, by the time we came out of the canyon, you couldn't see the sun. It was pure haze. These are just a couple more before, you know, this is a before, during, and after. This is a typical day. This is what you see in the sky. That haze, we have haze all the time. That's all airplane trails. Those waves, it's created by HARP. Now, you look at that picture. Do those look like ice crystals? So I guess what I'm asking is that you watch the sky, remember what it used to look like, do your research. Everybody has a different path with the research. And one of the things you have to do first is believe that the government would even do this. And the only way you can come to that conclusion is you start doing the research on what the government has done. And there's plenty of proof out there. There's a site called the Black Vault. I spent a lot of time on that. It's all original government documents covering things like MK Ultra and all sorts of experiments that our own government has done in the past. Inform others. I know people that I've informed that inform others. Thank you for listening.
Stay up there for questions. Do you need a break?
No, I'm good.
Okay, Brahm's going to ask. May I ask the first question, Brahm?
Yes, Tim.
Okay. What possible motive would the government have for doing this program, and why would they be spraying these chemicals all over the place? Did you get into that in your research, or is it just, is it climate change?
To stop global warming. To stop climate change. That, as David Keith says, there's more of a risk to not do it and not stop global warming than there would be to do it.
Okay. Use the microphone.
That's okay. No problem. Okay.
Okay. Gene Harker.
You mentioned This Changes Everything by Naomi Klein. I'm reading that, but I haven't read the whole book. You feel, first of all, did you read the book? And second of all, do you agree generally with what she says?
I honestly skipped right to the chapter called Dimming the Sun. I agree with everything she said in there. And it was very informative.
Thank you.
Yes, David Pratt.
Travis.
Sorry.
You describe yourself as a birder, among other things. How does that differentiate from an ornithologist?
I am not a scientist. Ornithologists are scientists that study birds. It's a hobby to me. Matter of fact, if I was at an Audubon meeting, I would probably not even call myself a birder because I'm pretty new at it.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's all sorts of different. I'm a casual birder.
Do you think you'll do a big year?
To what extent does the content of your presentation inform the International Protocol on Climate Change? Do they know about it?
Does the International...
The International Protocol on Climate Change. It's an international group.
Oh, yes. Yes, they recommend doing geoengineering. They recommend doing it. There are all sorts of bodies that recommend doing it. The thing is, nobody's admitting that it's being done. Yes. They're right in the thick of things. Yes. As a matter of fact, I have they wrote a very large document that covers geoengineering, why it should be done. You know, who's going to govern it is the big question. Naomi Klein talks about that at length in her Dimming the Sun, that chapter. She is at a Royal Society meeting in England, and she said that the topic was not should we do it. The topic was who is going to control it, who is going to govern it.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, I sent her an email and I asked.
All right, Clayman.
You know, unfortunately, I missed most of your show. I had a real big commitment. Aviation's been pretty much had a pass on air pollution for decades and decades. But, you know, coincidentally, the EPA finally in the Obama administration says, hey, you know, all this jet fuel and pollution is a climate change effector, a major polluter.
They're talking about emissions.
Yeah.
These aren't emissions. This is being deliberately sprayed.
Yeah, that's what I think. That's the gist of what I got. Yeah. So. But did you see that that came out this week?
Yes, and I said, too bad. That's not really, it was all over the airwaves in our groups. Mm-hmm. But I said, but this is emissions that he's talking about.
But at least it was something.
It's something.
Yeah, because
at least it's
there's
something.
Been nothing been done about aviation pollution for eons.
Yes.
Tom Summer.
I have
Shepard.
Thank you. Two observations, and one you talked about the birds. Well, you talked about both actually, and mine is not a scientific study or anything, but I walk every day for a couple miles a day and make observations, and I walk with walking partners, and over the last couple of years we've noticed a decline in bird population, and I'm not saying that this is could be the only cause. But the other thing, I think it very possibly could be. The other observation is trees, and particularly the tops of trees nowadays. And when we go around, they're pretty healthy right now at this point in time because of all the rain and cool weather we've had and everything. But later this summer, we'll start seeing the tops of trees very unusual. I've been noticing this just in the past few years that it's really occurring more and more. Have you any thoughts on those topics? The tops of trees are browning and dying off at the top.
They are, and I will have to tell you, when I first started seeing this, you tend to think everything bad that you see is because of these chemtrails. What are they spraying? You know, and so I've been. There is a group called the Tree Decline, and it is a group of people across the world that are gathering pictures of dead and dying trees. But they are careful to say that you can't prove, and we don't know that this is because of chemtrails. But is it? I don't know. But every tree I see now, and they are, what I really see that's disconcerting to me is the trees all seem to have like a green fungus on them. Either that or they're like burning. They don't look healthy. And I do know that out in California, where the spraying has been heavy for a long time, there's a huge tree decline there, and they have done sample soils, and they do tie it directly to the chemtrails. So I guess I kind of think it is, but can we prove it? I don't know, but let's all keep watching.
Charlie?
Yeah, Nancy, you had the logos of virtually the entire federal government of the United States, the civilian workforce, is involved in some fashion in this conspiracy, but the only person you could come up with was the the girl who got thrown out of the Air Force. Is there no others?
There is an ex-FBI official who came out and was a whistleblower, who is Ted Gunderson. There are several other whistleblowers, but there aren't a lot. So I don't know. I don't know why. I don't know if they get kicked out, and who knows what kind of contracts they sign. I mean, I find a hard time believing that it doesn't get out, but I also looked at, you know, projects like the Manhattan Project, where they had 140,000 people for 4 years building something, and none of them knew what they were building. I mean, so they were keeping that quiet. Yeah, it's hard to believe that they can keep this quiet, but number one, do the people know what they're... Like, Kristen Megan was only a cog in the wheel. So do they know what they're working on? Do the pilots know they're even spraying it? It could be, you know, run by a computer. I don't know, but I can tell you this. There's always a cry and a call for, we need whistleblowers.
Right. Yes. I wanted to dovetail on what Tom said about trees, that the Morton Arboretum now has an exhibit of trees that are in peril, that are dying. So they're aware of it.
Okay.
Well, so I was wondering why our weathermen never talk about that it's always gray here now. Do the weathermen ever?
That's another big controversy. Why do the weathermen not talk about what's happening? I've gotten into so many discussions with weathermen on the internet and via emails, and I try to get them to say, this isn't normal. I mean, we don't have tornadoes in Seattle in the middle of summer. I mean, there are weather extremes and anomalies that are going all across the country, and they just say it's all because of extreme weather and climate change. And now they're calling it filtered sun. They have all these different words for sunlight now. I mean, it's not very rare that you ever see a pure sunny day. And the days they say that are sunny, quite frankly, if you look at the sky, it's light blue. It's not the deep, beautiful blue that we knew when we were growing up.
Okay. You say that, I mean, sorry, I did miss most of your presentation, but you're saying that they're doing this to try to geoengineer to mitigate the effects of climate change, of global warming. Mm-hmm. Why would they keep this secret? I don't really understand. I mean, wouldn't it have to be studied by scientists? I mean, why are they keeping it secret? Is it like denying climate change?
Because they know people would not agree. I actually found a study that looked at, would people agree to this? And it came down and said, no, people would never agree to this. So I think that, and there was an executive order that Obama came out with recently, and in it said something to the extent that, I will do anything I need to do to keep this country safe, and basically unilaterally. It had to do with the weather.
But weren't people complaining of chemtrails when Bush was in power as well? And I find it hard to believe that he would do something like this.
Clinton, too.
I mean, he had scientists. Scientists were going around and altering documents and making it
right.
Seem like climate change wasn't as bad as it was.
Right.
So, I mean,
right.
Do you think Bush would be doing this? I mean, how far do you think this has been going on? And who, you know, it seems just a little far-fetched that all the presidents would be agreeing to this.
I don't know if the presidents are in control, quite frankly. I don't know who's running the programs openly. I don't know. I don't have an answer to that. There's a lot of things that they do that I don't understand why they do. I don't know why they put fluoride in water still.
If they're doing something to try to combat climate change, it would behoove them to try to get the scientific community to study it, to try to
figure
out whether it's even working.
The scientific community has studied it on computer models for decades. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the things that Naomi Klein talks about when she talks about research, she says that you cannot do a small test. It would have to be a very large test. It would have to be over a decade, and it would affect millions of people. Because we're talking about the Earth's climate, that you can't just do a little bit like David Keith says. I mean, that's, you've got a scientist coming out and saying, do it a little bit. That's very suspicious in my book. But I think that maybe they are doing, maybe this is research. Maybe we're in the middle of their research phase. And then maybe, as a matter of fact, there are a lot of articles that have been come out recently saying, it was in the Washington Post, it was in the New York Times, there were articles coming out and saying, probably all the same author, oh, by the way, if we start this, we can't stop it. So I felt like they were telling us ahead of time, if we start, we can't stop.
With the geoengineering?
Stop the geoengineering. If we start the spraying, we can't stop it because then it'll get hot too quickly.
Well, and Meister?
Yes. I just wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, everybody's focusing on the fact that this is to rescue us from climate change, which used to be called global warming. I'd just like to throw out a few thoughts because a lot of people aren't aware of the fact, you know, you talked about the insurance policies. Weather is traded on weather derivatives are traded on the mercantile exchange or the commodities, okay? So there's a lot of people making money out of what's happening in different areas of the country. People have lost their farmlands who've been flooded out. I mean, there's all kinds of things happening. I'm not done. I do have one question, though. Because when they talk about protecting us from the sun with aluminum, and I go to Arizona twice a year. We have a home there. And you're right, the skies used to be crystal blue there. Mm-hmm. No longer. But I can tell you what it makes you feel like when you're in the valley. It's trapping the heat. It is not protecting us from anything. So I'm having a hard time buying into this idea.
Yes. And it has to come to a question.
Well, and I have one more thing,
otherwise,
too.
Otherwise,
you
do it in
the
There's 5,000 new environmental laws going on the books this year.
We don't listen to people.
There's people that are making a lot of money off of them. We're the people that are going to be paying.
Let me remind
everybody that this is the question period. In about 8 minutes or so, we're going to give you a free rein on the mic. You'll get about 4 or 5 minutes to speak, and be able to take care of it. And we thank you, though, but it's one of our peculiarities. I understand.
Well, everybody was asking questions.
There's no problem.
Yes. No. If the government of the United States, I'm wondering, why don't they muck around with the skies of places, a little known place like Lithuania? Where are they doing Arizona and California? I mean, and Raj, you're from India.
Why don't they do that?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, if you're going to experiment with the skies, and you have the United, by the way, what's the United Nations symbol was also in there as well? Is that a conspiracy as well?
They're involved via the IPCC.
Which is, what's the
International Planetary Commission.
So they got to them too, right?
Some people, there are a lot of theories. Some people think that at the next climate conference, I think it's in December, that they're mainly going to be talking about governance and that the UN is going to want to take control of the governance and that they will have their finger on the world's climate. I don't know. I'm just telling you, these are some of the things that I'm reading. The only thing I know for sure is that I see it happening. And I know those aren't contrails, and I know they're blocking the sunlight. And some people talk about, is that what's causing global warming? Are they creating a problem to ride in and fix it and end up with control of the weather? There are all sorts
of theories out there. They bring in Agenda 21, they bring in all sorts of different ideas. But again, that's where your own research comes into play.
Tim, how are we running for time?
We got about maybe, it's about 3 minutes to eight. Why don't we take a couple more questions and go to rebuttals?
Don Ritchie, and then leaving you on.
Okay, all right, ma'am. When did the anti-chemtrail movement get started?
The debunking of
No. What I mean is the movement in opposition to the movement you're part of.
When
did your movement get started? I don't mean when did you get involved in it. I mean
When did it start?
Yeah, that's what I want to know.
10 years ago? You know, the thing about this movement is that it is not much of a movement. It's all fractured. I mean, it took me a long time to even find anybody to talk to about this. Because, you know, you think people are going to think you're crazy. I mean, if you asked me a year ago if I would be here even talking about it in public, I would have said, oh, it took me a long time to even tell my family about what I was seeing. But then, the more you see it, the more you know it's happening, and I've got to do something about it.
All right.
For those of you who are new to the college, we have a habit of lining up before the rebuttals period in chairs near the speaker's stand. So be prepared to move over in this direction.
Join us.
If you have something you want to add. Li Ping?
Yeah, I just wonder, do you have any...
it's okay.
Do you have any historical data, say, when the chemtrail started and then when it gets popular to nowadays?
Some people say there's no real historical data.
Okay.
It's all anecdotal. It's all people that talk about it and say, well, I saw it. I saw them back in the 70s. I started seeing them in the 80s. You know, more in the 90s. I will say this, when I first saw these, I did get in touch with some people in Chicago, and I said, how could I not have seen this? And they said, it's been going on in here, it's been going on in Chicago for, she was seeing it the last 5 years, but it's 10 times worse than it has been over this past year.
Okay. Let's go to rebuttals, Brahm.
Thank you very much.
Instead of having the dogs, could you just flip through the PowerPoint real fast so I could see the slides? How do you send it to me?
I'll email it to you.
You will?
Yes. Send me an email. I'll email it.
You have bullets from this country like
okay. Okay. That's a short list.
About five.
All right. So.
About 5 minutes, Brahm?
At least 5 minutes.
Okay. Hang on. Let me get the.
My fellow Americans.
Our first rebutter is Joe Mayer.
I wouldn't say rebutter, but commentator. First of all, I am a scientist. I'm an astrophysicist. Plasma is, as our speaker mentioned, an ionized gas. And as an ionized gas, it can be spectroscopically analyzed. So we need to turn spectroscopes on these chemtrails. Particularly if they're in direct line with the sun, in which case they will absorb certain wavelengths which will identify them. Very, very easy to do. Astrophysicists are building huge telescopes in the mountains of Chile and Peru at 14,000 to 16,000 feet. And they're spending billions and billions of dollars to put these telescopes up there. And if their vision is compromised by the plasma that's being generated, the chemtrails, then that's a real problem. because first of all, they won't get the data that they need, and second, it's a waste of time and money. But astrophysicists enjoy that. From time to time, in the from March until October, I hold telescope viewing sessions at a nature center on the south side. And I've been doing this for 10, 12 years. There's a phenomenon that I have noticed. I always have the viewing on the Saturday that's closest to the first quarter moon, so that the people will be able to see something on the moon. You know, see, they always get the wow expression. But 10 years ago, when I would be doing this in March and again in October, the moon occupies only a small portion of the sky. It's about 30 seconds of arc, not even a degree. And I used to see every 3 to 4 seconds a migrating duck or goose fly directly between me and the moon, which if you extrapolate that, you can see that the whole sky must have been covered with migrating fowl. But in the last 3 years, I have never seen a duck or a goose cross the moon. It's incredible. And I think that you're onto something.
Our system is based on profit. It's not based on human need. And the system wants to keep going. It's not a system that wants to destroy itself and is trying to figure out some way to stop the global warming. Of course, the global warming is getting worse. It's very obvious. If you look at California, drought, Texas, drought. If you look at Alaska, the snow caps are melting. If you look at the Antarctic, miles and miles and miles of ice is broken off. And it's pretty obvious that if we keep on going like we are, there won't be any planet for anybody to live on any longer. So that's why they're doing this. They want to make sure that the profit system keeps going. And this book, this changes everything. I didn't read it. I read a synopsis of it. And what Naomi Klein is trying to say, essentially, we can't keep living in the type of system that bases itself on profit.
Yeah.
There's no way we could do this, and this changes everything. In other words, we got to go to a system that is not based on profit, but based on human need. And for people to understand this, they have to read a lot, they have to research and so forth, and certain people are doing that. But the information is not getting across, let's face it. If you put on the television, you listen to radio, you read the newspapers, they never talk about global warming. It's like it's not even happening. So the newspapers and the TV are all controlled by corporations. And they're part of the problem. They're part of the economic system that is based on profit. So you're not going to get that from them. What you have is a movement that really understands what's happening. I think Naomi Klein is trying to point this out. I didn't read the book, but I'm going to get it eventually. And this is the crux of the problem. Now, we could talk about this little thing and this little thing happening, but if you put it all together, this economic system is not viable. And will destroy the earth. It'll destroy everything on it. So we have to change the economic system. That is the basis of getting rid of this global warming. If you have this system like we're having, we'll be like the moon or like Mars eventually.
What do we got?
Five.
Here,
reset. Yeah.
My name is Elton Anderson. I'm from the Northwest Information Service in Palatine. I'd like to thank our speaker for doing a tremendous job of trying to cram 50 pounds worth of information into a 20-pound bag. There, you always, after a speech like this, you say, oh, I forgot that, or I forgot they would have talked about that. You know, the questions all of you ask, there's tons of information on this, but when you're dealing with blacked out subjects, things that the press specifically censor, blackout, or fire reporters for trying to write about them, This is what you call not just a taboo, but a radioactive subject. If you try to go anywhere near this, and if you're a major media figure, you will just get fired and blackballed. On July 25th, I'm going to have a list of these books that talk about these kinds of things. A good one to start with is also the Censored News Project out of Sonoma State. Project Censored, they have the website. It's projectcensored.org, and they have 25 years worth of archives of 25 stories a year that are blacked out. The book Into the Buzzsaw was published in 2004 by a woman named Christina Borgesson. She collected the stories of 18 Pulitzer Prize winners. Some had worked for Fox, some had been at ABC. But she had 18 stories of people that had long careers in the media, and then one day they tried to report a story they thought would be of interest to the American people, and they just got fired and blackballed. Their career went into the buzzsaw. So that's the title of that book, Into the Buzzsaw, by Christina Borgesson. If you've never seen it, Google it. You get a copy at the library. There's a massive amount of knowledge, beneficial and otherwise, in books that is not in the mainstream media in America. And she mentioned, several people have mentioned, Naomi Klein's book, This Changes Everything. That's one of my top 10 books out of the hundreds that I've digested over the last 20, 25 years. That book, This Changes Everything, summarizes the failure of our capitalistic system and the solution, what must be done. We are living, Tom Hartman points this out. For those of you that don't know, there's a historian named Tom Hartman on the air every day from 11 to 2 on 820 AM. It's a strong station in Chicago, 820 AM. Tom Hartman talks about all these issues that we're talking about here. And he said many times over, stop that clock for a minute, would you, Tim? Yeah. Are you guys going to get with the program anytime soon? So I can. It's a tremendous thought breaker. I'm trying to concentrate. Thank you. I'll do the best I can.
Okay.
It's like trying to talk when somebody is whispering something else in your ear. Okay. Can't concentrate like I used to. Go back. Yeah. Start again. Yeah. As our previous author said, our system is based on profit. It's not based on human needs or anything else. What we've got, Tom Hartman talks about our system of unregulated capitalism. We are living, it really picked up speed in 1980 with Reaganomics. And now, we're living in the greatest failure of an economic governing system in the history of the human race. It's the greatest failure that anybody has ever seen. And these books all spell it out. Again, I'll mention Unprecedented. Can civilization survive the CO2 crisis? It's full of solutions. Albert Einstein, before he died, Albert Einstein, one of his famous quotes was that the human race is in a race between education and extinction. I'm not sure who's winning. Many, many other authors, famous people of one stripe or another, have said the same thing. But this book, The Collapse of Western Civilization, talks about the issues that we were talking about here tonight, about predators, the billionaire predators who stole the American dream. The people have been running America for the last 40 years or so. they're the billionaires that own the companies that are behind top secret projects like this one. And they're behind the change in our military. Since 2001, there's been a total change in how the military advertises to young people. You're going to be defending in freedom and justice in foreign lands. That's not what's happening. We puncture some myths. You get rid of the mythology, and it, like she said, many people have said over the years, you study some of these, the young woman there said, when I looked at this, you can't believe what's happening. Your life had just sucked down a rabbit hole when you start doing research on one of these blacked out subjects. So I'll have a, you know, an up-to-date list of the current blacked out ones for 2015 and some printed lists from the last 15 to 20 years for those of you that are interested to find out what the media has been blacking out. Project Censored publishes, the book is, this will be my last thought, it's about this size. It says, it'll say Censored 2015, Censored 2014. Sonoma State University puts that book out every year with the top 25 media suppressed blacked out stories that would change America overnight if they were covered rather than blacked out. And it's an amazing project. And many journalists, many people working in the field of journalism have never heard of Project Censored. As I said, it's like being a sports writer in Chicago for 30 years, lived here for 30 years, and Michael, who? Who's Michael?
I don't know.
Well, yeah, if you could find somebody that would be that ignorant, it would show you what the local media is doing. So, once you get outside the bubble and start looking at solutions, there are solutions going on all over the world to this. But as she said, this is being kept secret because people wouldn't go for it. They wouldn't go for it anywhere in the world. Thank you.
My name is Raj Patel, and I have a couple of degrees in engineering. I have read lots of about in scientific books. I have gone to scientific presentation of papers. But I know one thing. This kind of issue, not presented in a proper scientific forum, in a proper format, and on top of that, there is a conspiracy theater is worth nothing to me. Okay? That is not a valid way to discuss this issue. Okay, I'm going to talk about some different issues. The Newbury event, if I get to speak, I'll be speaking on Black America, and I'll be presenting some ideas which are not presented and political ideas. One of my most admired congressmen, Henry Waxman, he retiring, and guess what he's going to do? He's going to be a lobbyist. He was the strongest person, anti-lobby guy in a Congress. Now he's going to be a lobbyist. So that is the way world works, and that is the way it's going to work, whether you like it or not. China is about same group. China GNP is about same as ours at this time. In a way, China will be growing and will be growing. In 20 years, China will be having twice the GNP we have. And that is a lot. Second thing, we have a dollar as an international currency. And that will be in a big danger. Because other international currency China is presenting, that will be there. And lots of people will go to that. Okay. So, that's where comes to Pacific Ring, the trade deal in Congress right now. And that deal was lost, but it will come back. And I think this will pass. Because this is very important. We are talking about lots of commerce bring ourselves, United States, in a play and in influence and a part of the whole thing. If he cannot do that, it will be a huge problem. Other thing is entirely different is about Israel Prime Minister Netanyahu. If you guys know, a few years back, Prime Minister fired his Chief of Army and Chief of Intelligence Agency. And everybody believed that those two guys, they subordinated the government's power. Now it comes out is that it is not so. But Prime Minister Netanyahu cannot get the approval from the Security Council, the Israeli they have, in order to mobilize the forces to do that, they need that particular authorization. It did not happen. So Netanyahu fired them. After election, new election, he appointed other groups. And other group did agree with the first group. So Netanyahu presents great danger to United States and Israel and whole world. But that is more complex. His plan was that he mobilized the military there, attack Iran's nuclear facility, and that will create an international crisis, and then America will be forced, Iran will try to attack Israeli, and America will be forced to attack them, and then there will be peace, and then Iran will be have to let go that nuclear program, or they have to be accept very intrusive inspection. Now, intrusive inspection is there, and an Israeli army chief, and an intelligence chief, what they wanted, we are achieving that for them. And still, Netanyahu now is not agreeing. Whole objective was his was that we get intrusive inspection and some kind of control over program. That is happening. So I do not know. I think, you know, sad thing is that all the Jewish people here in America and large majority of Americans support Netanyahu. There's more support here than there. Okay, and this is a problematic. And I would like Israel and America have an understanding that how to conduct our relationship that is legitimate, peaceful, and a mutual respect and a mutual interest taken care of. Right now, America's interest is not taken care of, and Netanyahu is a loose cannon, and we should try to get rid of him as soon as we can. Thank you.
All right.
Okay. All right. I thought this was a real interesting presentation. Presentation was very well done, and I thought our speaker was a very good public speaker, and she's obviously done a lot of research on this, and the slideshow was real good too. However, I do have some issues with all this. First, this whole question of the so-called chemtrails. Nothing about this is proven. This is all speculation. And in this presentation, our speaker points up some things that are true, like the fact that there are more airplanes in the sky, and also that there's more air pollution. But then she draws from this some conclusions that are just speculation. It's true there is more air pollution all over the United States. And by the way, it doesn't have to be caused by airplanes flying over, because air pollution, this has been proven, air pollution can travel very long distances. They've actually found that particulate matter from factories in China will blow across the Pacific Ocean to North America. So, air pollution from California has been documented as far east as Arizona and Utah. The Grand Canyon is more polluted, the air polluted, because of people driving their cars in Los Angeles. So the fact that there's more air pollution in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan with even less industry means nothing. And there could be less people in that local area and you could still have more air pollution. And that brings me to another question. Asthma can be caused by air pollution, but it can be caused by a lot of things besides aluminum in the air. Just more carbon in the air can give you asthma. This has been documented. Now there's something else. Our speaker tonight talked about patents. I don't really find the existence of patents very convincing because it doesn't prove that the technology is real. You see, the U.S. government will actually grant patents to people even when they don't actually have a working model, when they haven't actually haven't actually proven something real. They'll grant the patent even if it's only in the experimental or speculative stage. Now, and speaking of speculation, our speaker speculated on the causes of of the various problems, and then she treats her speculation as an already proven fact. For example, the aluminum levels in the atmosphere. Now, another thing I would like to just mention is the whistleblower. And I was really interested to hear this woman from the Air Force, who she called whistleblower. But then I found that there really wasn't any there, because she actually found out about this whole thing from her actual work or from actual government documentation, but from the web, from the internet, or from talking to people who believed in chemtrails. So she isn't like Bradley Manning or Edward Snowden. It's completely different. And the whistleblower who spoke does not actually know whether chemtrails exist or not. She thinks they might exist. For example, she doesn't know, if you listen carefully to what she said in her speech, she doesn't know the chemicals that she had to approve. In this case, the chemicals that she was suspicious of, she didn't know what they were used for or how they were used. Now, this is typical of how conspiracy theorists will take something unknown, for example, because it may be classified by the government, and then they'll just jump in and start speculating about what it is, and then they go the next step and they start treating their speculation as an already proven fact upon which they base more speculation. So, finally, our speaker got something factually wrong about the history of the anti-chemtrail movement, as I call it. That's the movement. That's the movement in opposition to chemtrails. And because she said that the anti-chemtrail movement started 10 years ago, which would make the starting date 2005. However, earlier in her presentation, she noted that the term chemtrails, she said the term was used by the government. It actually was used by Representative Dennis Kucinich in a bill that he introduced to Congress, which didn't pass, which was to ban putting chemical additives in the air, like the chemtrail theorists are saying is being done. Maybe I should, rather than call it an anti-chemtrail movement, because as far as I can tell, there doesn't seem to be any movement to actually get the government, except for that bill introduced by Kucinich, there doesn't seem to be any movement to actually stop it. It's more like it would be more likely to call them chemtrail theorists. By the way, if the government, and I like the point Ellen made, if the government was actually doing something to stop global warming, I'd be very happy. Unfortunately, I think those who believe the government is doing something to stop global warming are far too optimistic. And I also think that people who think the government knows what the hell they're doing are also far too optimistic, in my opinion.
I'd like to talk to you later.
We can talk, Charlie. But now, I just want to say something else real quick. Both Sid and Andy attributed the all these problems to capitalism, which I think is missing the speaker's point, because she's not accusing private industry, she's accusing the government of doing this. Okay. Second point is that air pollution, if you're just talking about air pollution, it's a serious problem in China and the USSR, and they're communists. Well, the USSR doesn't exist anymore.
And Don, you're out of time.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Okay. David Travis.
Good evening.
Or you can have your attention.
Good evening. I'd like to say that the global warming is a fact. Global warming because of automobiles that are polluting and factories that are polluting is a fallacy. About every 10,000 years, the planet undergoes a period of warming. We had an ice age, and around the time of George Washington, we had a period called the Little Ice Age. One volcano can spew out more pollution than all the factories and automobiles do in probably 50 or 60 years. So the global warming is not because of things connected with human endeavor. It's connected to natural phenomena. But what I want to say here is that I do agree with Nancy Hill that something is going on. We didn't used to see all of these lines in the sky that we see, and there's nothing that in her photographs that is lying about what we're talking about. People have said that what she does is just conjecture, but there's no conjecture in the lines that she has photographs of, or the fact that the sun doesn't shine like it did. So there is something wrong, and the government won't tell us. The government does not want us to know a lot of things. I would connect this along with the idea of sightings of spacecrafts, and there are many sightings of so-called flying saucers, and every time there are, the government will poo-poo it and say that, no, that was a weather balloon, or it was this or that or the other thing. So apparently, somebody does not want the government to let the people know what's behind of this phenomena with the weather. And it probably is not a foreign power here on Earth, but it may very well be that there are certain alien beings that the government supposedly knows about and simply won't tell the people. And as a consequence of this and other such things, the government has gotten to the point that people in general no longer trust the government. So we're really in a kind of a dilemma. People don't trust the government doesn't let people know things, the government insists that it's just ordinary things and so forth. So, and the experts estimate that about 100,000 people every year disappear. Now that's a lot of people, and yet the experts have shown that this is a fact. So there is something that is up. Thank you for listening to me.
All right. Okay. Next, Gene Anderson.
I won't respond to Don. Now,
move the mic up, will you?
Gave a pretty good
tilt the mic. Tilt the mic up more towards you. Okay, that's better. Okay, go ahead.
When he made the statement about how people can get certain information, incomplete information, and they come to something and points out, and he was saying, and at least I'm thinking that's what he's trying to say, that their position is weak because of lack of this or that, A or B. However, we are all human beings that are limited, and we don't know everything. However, most human beings got the same kind of makeup as another human being, a brain, an eyes, and an ear. And if any honesty is in that human being, and he used these things that nature gave him, he has or she has a right to make comments about it. Now, I've started watching Chemtrails at least 15 years ago. I'm sorry. I'd have made a mistake that I cried about. Chemtrails. I'm familiar with Chemtrails.
Why? Because I was in the army. Why? Because I was 15 looking at the sky. Why? Because I read what they said. This is condensation. Condensation and chemicals is two different things. Now, and this is what the speaker was talking about. And these are the things that you come to your conclusion on when you see them. Now, 15 years ago, I see that, and they got all these guys, and you talk to somebody, they say, contrails. That's not a contrail. A contrail only lasts a few seconds. When they come in contact, the heat come in contact with the coolness. A chemtrail, like the speaker showed in the thing there, will last for an hour, or will last, spread out and so forth and so on. This is what she's pointing out. Now, we all relate Obama, the president, and by the way, 15 years ago was before his time, talk about what we got to do to save the earth from heated global warming. To save the earth from global warming. And he have said this on television, yes, somebody reported in the newspaper, he have said that in foreign countries, but he and nobody that represent him told me what the hell they were spraying up in there. Oh, that's some kind of secret? And you go tell me all about this and blah, 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 blah? What are people that somebody else is about saying something about this is an economic system that they look for profit? Forget about what the human being is needed. That is true all the way around. Now, if he can't tell me what's up there, that must be something that he don't want us to know. Well, another thing that a human being can do after a length of time, and I got the time, and if the governor didn't tell me nothing about this, I figured it out. He didn't want me to know about that. And when he told me about something else, that was a distortion, a distraction, and a lie. And consequently, and subsequently, when the government tell me something, I'll have to go and do my research. And if they don't tell me nothing, then I know they hiding something.
I don't think I need a whole 5 minutes. I just wanted to comment on, I think it's unfortunate when people think that you have to be a scientist to present any of this stuff. A lot of us are fairly intelligent people, and you know, many of us have been observing what's going on in the skies for a long time. Clearly we can't prove it, but my research has found is showing me more that this global warming thing, which I think is interesting, turned into climate change after we had a few really cold winters. You know, so everybody's bought into the climate change things. You know, when you start observing the skies and you see what, and you read and understand what they're spraying, you know, the idea of blocking the sun to protect us doesn't really make any sense, because spraying aluminum in the sky would only keep the heat in, is the way I would look at it. But there's a lot of good people in this movement, and I don't understand when people come along to try to debunk it, because they don't really know either. You know, all we're doing is observing, and that's what everybody can do. And when you start watching the skies, you'll have no question about it. And when you start doing research, you'll see that our government has done a lot of things to us in the past. They've done a lot of experimentation. There's a lot of people making a lot of money off of this. As I mentioned before, I don't know if people heard, their weather derivatives are traded on the commodity exchange. Yeah. All right, now, why would you trade weather unless you know what the weather's going to be? You know, there's droughts in California. There's people losing their land because of that. And there's many of us who believe that this is all engineered. There's the North Pole. There's a lot of oil under there. Is it melting up there because of us driving our cars? Is it a coincidence? You know, who's going to get all this oil? You know, so people really need to start looking into things. There's something called Agenda 21 that I would highly recommend people research. This is all connected. Nancy talked about HAARP. They're able to see into the ground with HAARP. They can find oil.
They can find enemies' bunkers. They can create earthquakes by shooting a lot of energy into the earth. Right? So they're doing whatever they want to us is basically what it is. Something I wanted to point out, though, for people who don't believe geoengineering is actually going on, Rhode Island has a bill. It's House Bill 5480. And in February, they were asking for people to comment. It's a bill to ban geoengineering in Rhode Island. Now, if this didn't exist, why would they be coming out with this bill?
Because they want to preempt it. They want
to
preempt it.
Okay, all I'm going to say, because I don't need to say anymore, is watch your skies and pay attention. All right, because anybody who does not see what's being done to us is either in denial because they can't face it, because let me tell you, your life changes when you realize what they're doing to us. So, that's all I got to say. And I want one more thing I would like to say. For any of you who fly, watch out your windows when you're flying, okay? Because the commercial airlines are also spraying. I had a Southwest airline that came by my plane last year, and because it was so close, it caught my eye because it came by so fast. And as soon as it passed the back of the plane I was on, the sprayers went on. I had never seen anything like that before in my life, and that was my confirmation, because they waited until they passed our plane. And I was watching this plane, and they came on. Okay, so it wasn't condensation. It was in mid-flight, so I can't imagine it was dumping fuel. So we need more people to be aware of this, because we have to stop it. You know, it's our duty as Americans to get this stopped. So thank you.
All right, let me move this stuff here. All right, let's thank our speaker again. I know she spent some time working on this, putting together a PowerPoint of 85 slides. I looked at it, I snuck a peek at it earlier today. I'll be eclectic as usual, bouncing around here. We have to understand that there's a difference between a correlation and causality. Now, if I take off my hat and I tap myself on the top of the head, my head, an airplane takes off at O'Hare Airport.
Right.
Right.
Does that mean that tapping the top of my head
causes
airplanes to fly? Now, you have to gather data. I spent some time with some Christians, and they were attributing all sorts of, how could I call them, incidences of life were attributed to a higher power. Because there was a correlation between event A and event B. And you have to gather some real serious data. And Joe, hello there. Let's gather some real data on, birds in my scope. You have to have mathematics. You have to have measurements. You've got to have tests. We heard some of this, and that's it. Yes, the burden of proof is on you. But anyhow, I'll leave that alone. This week we had the little group. We argue about airplanes versus trains. We've been doing it for some time. This week, the United States government, the Environmental Protection Agency, issued a thing that is going to look into the topic of emission standards they are going to establish for airplanes. Now, I don't know why they would be doing this if they're surreptitiously spraying the skies with their own substances. It doesn't connect there. So, they are going into looking into what's coming out of the airplanes. There presently are no standards. Emission standards for airplanes. Now, regarding whistleblowers, I've had many, many years to deal with whistleblowers. And I was really interested, and when you had this one there, I got a maybe, I don't want to kill the messenger, but she didn't quite have enough, you know. You gotta, in order to be a whistleblower, you have to truly, the burden again is on the whistleblower, you have to establish that there was some violation of law, rule, or regulation. You know, and I have to advise people whether they should pursue cases of whistleblowing and protect them, whistleblowers, on many occasions. So, now, the other thing is, there's a difference between weather and climate. And I don't know if chemtrails, or trails, I guess we're supposed to call them, are changing the weather or the climate. I will say that the military, I like military history to some extent, it was very beneficial to any military force to be able to control certainly the weather. That's been decisive in determining the outcome of any conflicts in the course of history. So yeah, they have a very vested interest in doing this. Now the one thing I've got to draw the line on, and I spent a lot of years as a member of the United Nations Association as an officer, is that I saw the little logo there that the UN is part of this conspiracy.
That's right, they are, Charlie.
I don't know about that.
You guys want to
now they come out with a agenda. No, the other thing amazed me, we got speakers here. They came out with Agenda 21. They come out with these all the time. I usually don't pay more attention, but to certain conservative elements make this into some nefarious, oh, they're taking over the earth, you know, and the little
they
things
are.
That say they have goals that every child will have one cup of food to eat per day is a goal, or feed the children of the world. I mean, these are not like evil things, you know, if you look at them, but definitely. And last of all, though, I have to give Dave credit. I'm started getting into the topic of Martians. You know, in terms of the government cover-up of Martians.
Right.
Yeah, I've been studying even this footprints on Mars and things like that, and Martian movies.
Hey, Jim, Charlie.
Maybe I'll get a talk on that. But anyhow, thanks so much.
Can we have one fool at a time, please?
Oh, no.
All right, unfortunately, I missed most of the show, almost all of it.
Thank you, sir.
I've been researching a lot about jet aircraft.
Thank you, sir.
This company you're familiar with bombs over everything. There's not a more secretive industry in the world than the military-industrial oil aviation complex. It's extremely hard to find anything on these folks, and they want it just that way. And after 9/11, it got 10 times exponentially more hard to find information. As far as condensation, it's not condensation, it's air pollution. There's all the major components. Jet fuel comes out of oil, just like gasoline comes out of oil, just like all this carbon pollution comes out of oil. So there's carcinogens, there's carbons, there's monoxides, there's all everything. It's not just water vapor. They want you to buy that. Who thinks, let me see a raise of hand, is it better that we burn more oil? Who thinks that's better, that we burn even more oil in this world?
We have to know the other.
Or should we burn less oil? Can I see, is it a good idea to burn less oil?
Why not? Come on.
Of course, it's a better idea to burn less oil. So anyway, I have some advice for our speaker. Since it's extremely hard to tell what's coming out of jet engine exhausts or jet engines or whatever, airplanes, whatever, I did a little research on the EIS at O'Hare Airport, the Environmental Impact Statement. Apparently, there's air pollution monitoring stations, a couple dozen that encircle O'Hare. And also, there's a couple dozen monitoring stations out here within like about a 10-mile radius of O'Hare. All specifically for the purpose of monitoring all the air pollution. The O'Hare Airport is obviously the biggest air polluter in Chicago. And they're all out there monitored. There's monitoring stations. I don't know how effective they are. I don't know how well they're monitored. I don't know who's in control of them. I don't know, big FAA, big oil, big Cheney, big military handles that, but I'm sure it's quite secret. That might be, since you like to research, it might be worth checking out. There's a specific name, I forget the names of these monitoring, air pollution monitoring stuff, but that might be a good idea to see what comes out of those jet engines and blocks our sun and pollutes the air, and who knows, it maybe even causes global warming and climate change, or helps. Thank you all.
What? Some of you guys are going to think I've blown a gasket. Some of you are going to think that I'm absolutely mad and a crackpot. Others of you are going to think that I have a solution to global warming. And the solution to maybe advancing our advanced industrial society.
Could it be thorium?
Exactly.
Thorium.
You see, I have presented here and many times in the past of the benefits of clean, safe nuclear power. Not the type that we're using today in the present day light water reactor, but Gen 4 reactors made with molten salts. I'm not going to get into the technology right now because many of you can simply Google it under thorium molten salt reactors. We've had John Kutch debate Dennis Nelson on this very subject. And for me, the debate is settled. We need to develop these reactors in order to save the planet. Frankly, I am getting a little sick of all of your environmentalist namby-pambies around here saying that wind and solar are going to do it all. The numbers simply don't add up. And what's it going to replace? Your peaking plants of natural gas, your coal, because people are still going to want power. And the only real way that I can see that happening is with Einstein's equation called E equals mc squared. No, I don't like the way nuclear power is done today. Neither does these people who are involved in the thorium movement. The reason we have these nuclear reactors today are they were developed for one reason. They're all copies of the submarine nuclear reactors that Admiral Rickover started when he was in the mid-40s, and it, like most anything else, the person who takes the development costs usually gets the first thing out. We had these reactors running at Oak Ridge for over 6,000 hours during the 60s. We had a gentleman by the name of Alvin Weinberg run these types of reactors for, again, quite a bit of time. We've had the government research in there, and it was stopped in 1973 because of what Nixon wanted to do was a fast breeder reactor, which also proved to be a fiasco. We have the technology to save our planet. We have the technology to make sure we run a good, advanced industrial civilization that we can clean things up. We have the means to do this. We could fit these reactors in the back of a truck, maybe make one the size of this restaurant to power the entire north side of Chicago, make them walk away safe because you don't have the high pressure of water and other things that go into it. You think I'm mad? Think I'm preposterous? Yes, think I'm preposterous. But let's look at it this way. Check out the claims. The scientific evidence is in my corner.
Who's your Congress?
Fukushima is a direct result of bad technology and bad design with the clouds.
It's scientific evidence.
The thing is, it was bad design.
Oh, here's the.
There has been no human killed in the development of nuclear power in over 50 years. You've only had three accidents, two of them due to bad design, and one of them basically due because it was never happened before. But when you compare deaths per thousand in the wind, or deaths per kilowatt, for example, on the nuclear, on other things, you're going to find that nuclear is completely a safe system.
Yeah.
I will simply say this to all of you guys who think that renewables are going to handle it, that conservation is going to handle it, and that we're going to have an advanced industrial society while some form of centralized, useful power like nuclear are absolutely nuts.
Can I see a fear to the diploma?
You're nuts.
I'll be right in.
Anybody else?
All right.
Thank Charlie for pointing out that there's a difference between correlation and evidence. We have plenty of coincidences without having a cause-effect relationship. All right. But I have to complain about people who come in here, sit themselves down late, and say, oh, but I missed part of the presentation. Oh, I ask questions, and I give my remarks, but why should I have to pay for the presentation when I didn't hear it all? Well, you missed it. I think we should charge extra for people who come late. Well, so, but then, that might augment our treasury and buy us a couple of extra meals. Or maybe we would start treating Nancy and our other speakers a little more generously, who come here to expose themselves to the hard questions and skepticism and denunciations at times that they may receive. Right. Thank you, Nancy, for giving us a very well worked out a personal account of your research and experience. And I hope that we'll hear from you again on the matter, because it's a continuing concern. Last week we had a presentation by Ron Batag, who was talking about atmospheric ionization for the purposes of making water in rather drought-stricken areas like California, where much of the nation's food crop is generated. It's a concern. That's geoengineering, and I don't know to what extent there may be geoengineering by our aeronautical industry and military. Raj Patel brought up the subject of Netanyahu and the coincidences of the interests of the Saudi royal family, the Sabahs in Kuwait, the Israelis. The world is full of political coincidences, and at this point I would say that's more of a correlation than a direct causation, but there are, politics does make strange bedfellows.
Our speaker gets the final word. Our speaker gets the final word.
Well,
I've been overexposed.
Okay, well, you're right, I am not a scientist, and I cannot prove that what we are seeing are chemtrails. But based on all the science that I've read, which came from NASA and scientific agencies, I was able to prove by looking at websites telling me what the relative humidity was and looking at radar telling me, you know, about, you know, what the elevation was, I was able to prove that those were not contrails. So I know they weren't contrails. I can't prove they're chemtrails unless I can get a jet and get right behind one of those guys and get an air sample from it. I mean, we want to raise awareness, so maybe one day I'll find somebody that can figure out how to do that, because you've got to file a flight plan, and if you're filing a flight plan that's going to be behind a plane that knows you're going to take an air sample, it's not going to spray anything, is it? So, you know, I've taken rain samples, and I've found barium, strontium, and aluminum in my rainwater in my backyard. Wow. But I can't tell, and I can't get anybody to tell me what the standards are. And can I correlate the fact that there are those heavy metals in my rainwater, can I prove that it came from the trails up there? No. You've got people lighting their water on fire, and they can't even prove that it's from the fracking that's right in their backyard. So the only way we can, if I can find somebody that can figure out how to get me an air sample, I'll be happy to camper.
Perimeter.
So, I did want to read, I did, when I first started doing research, and I realized that the wikis were changing their definitions and there was information that was not available to me, I thought, you know, I better start collecting old weather books, because I am not going to believe what I read pretty soon. And you already have NASA actually publishing information for children on WebQuest that's not true. But this book was written in 1943 by a weatherman, and I just want to close with this. He says, quite aside from the practical aspects of being airwise, there's a curiously satisfying pleasure in having an intelligent interest in the weather. There have always been those who loved it for its own sake, as born anglers love fishing regardless of the catch. These weather lovers are part scientist, part poet. They rejoice in the forms and colors that glorify the weather. They delight in extremes. They are gratefully aware that nobody can regulate the weather nor charge admission to it, and are happy that it is forever beyond the reach of politicians. We need to keep it that way. Okay? So, thank you for.